That building down there with the cross on it, that is the Downey Methodist Church, where the Carpenter kids played around in the choir, just a few feet away from what might be my favorite location on this entire tour. Right after they got their new house, they bought some investment properties, including a shopping center and some apartments. And oddly enough, the man they bought these apartments from took the money from this sale and he built his own house near the Carpenters over on Newville. Small, small town, but the best part is they named this building after the song that paid for them. I mean, come on, that's a pretty rock star move. Especially considering that after all these years, after all these decades, it still clings to the side of the building in all of its beautiful glory. I love it. Oh, I'm sorry, did I forget to mention that they bought two apartment complexes because they had two giant songs? Okay, I know a lot of people think that these songs are cheesy and sappy, but to me, they are examples of perfect recordings, and I'll even argue that they're not even Carpenter's best work or their biggest hits, but they paid for these investments, and their signage reminds you of that a half a century later. Look, quite serious about how great I think they are, and I want you to listen to the opening line of We've Only Just Begun. And notice how Karen, she starts real low, and the notes continue to climb as she delivers the entire phrase, We've Only Just Begun to Live, in one breath. Try it. It's extremely difficult to do, but it's that kind of phrasing that really makes her stand out from other singers.
We've only just begun to live. White lace and promises, a kiss for luck and we're on our way.
I swear, as I was out here recording, a lady drove out. She asked if I was looking to rent. I told her no and what I was doing, and she honestly lit up. She turned off her car and told me that when Richard sold the building several years ago, there was a clause in the contract stating that the names had to remain on the side of the building. And I even asked her if the songs get stuck in her head every time she drives home, and she was like, I wouldn't say stuck there. I like them there. Oh, love her.
On May 14th, 1971, Carpenters released their third album. I mean, you can see why they were living together. They were constantly working. Three albums in just over 2 years is pretty rare. This one was simply called Carpenters, and for the first time featured their brand new signature logo. Fans have nicknamed this the Tan Album, playing off of the Beatles' White Album, and it produced three massive hits. The first song came to them while they were taking a break on tour while in Canada. They just wanted to chill, go see a movie, so they saw a comedy called Lovers and Other Strangers, starring P. Arthur and Cloris Leachman, with Diane Keaton in her film debut and Sylvester Stallone as an extra. But work was still on the brain because there was a wedding scene that featured just a snippet of a song. And when Richard heard it, he thought it would make a fantastic hit. And he was correct. They immediately recorded and released For All We Know, and their version was so successful that it propelled the song to go on and win the Oscar for Best Original Song. Oddly enough, presented by Burt Bacharach.
Love, look at the two of us, strangers.
Love may grow for all we know.
second single, they once again turned to Paul Williams, who of course wrote their very successful bank jingle. This time, Paul wrote a song inspired by his mother, who apparently would walk around talking to herself about how old she felt. And once again, they struck gold. Although I'm not quite sure how it would look on the side of an apartment building, some fans say this is Carpenter's signature song.
Talking to myself and feeling old. Sometimes I'd like to quit. Nothing ever seems to fit. Hanging around, nothing to do but frown. Rainy days and Mondays always get me down. What I've got they used to call the blues. Nothing is really wrong. Feeling like I don't belong.
Single, the signature Carpenter song. There's really so many, but I happen to think this next track is the definitive Carpenter song. It captures their essence and sound so well, and Karen's vocals are, well, they're always full of raw emotion, but on this particular track, they are so haunting and so captivating, and I can wholeheartedly tell you this is the very first song I ever remember my mom listening to when I was a kid. Originally called Groupie, Richard first heard it on The Tonight Show, when Johnny Carson had a then unknown new singer named Bette Midler who was performing it. Richard thought with some rearranging and with Karen's vocals on it, he could have a smash hit on his hands. Written by Leon Russell and Bonnie Bramlett, who would go on to play Bonnie on Roseanne, the song was about female groupies and their obsession with musicians. Eventually, the title was changed to Superstar, and once again, Richard's intuition was correct.
Long ago, and oh so far away, I fell in love with you. Before the second show,
were once again nominated. They lost Album of the Year to Carole King's Tapestry, which I have to say is completely acceptable. They did win Best Pop Performance, beating out Sonny and Cher, Three Dog Night, and the Bee Gees. Everyone in the industry really seemed to love and respect Carpenters, except for maybe Bette Midler, who I think was a little jealous of Karen. She very publicly took shots at her, saying things like, Karen Carpenter is so white, she's invisible. Which is funny, coming from the future Wind Beneath My Wings singer, but Karen took it in stride. She even said it felt like Bette was paying tribute to her. But Bette was really relentless. She even attacked Karen's physical appearance, finally prompting Karen to remind everyone by saying, the gold record for Superstar hangs on our wall, not Bette's. Touché. To Bette's credit, though, years later, she expressed deep regret and remorse and apologized profusely for years of harassment towards Karen.
Winner is Bette Midler.
My dear, isn't that a hoot? Me and Miss Karen, what a hoot. Thank you very much. I'm surprised you didn't hit me over the head with it. Thank you very much.
Carpenters were absolutely crushing it. Everything they touched was turning to gold, but they did start to receive a little bit of criticism. Their recordings were perfect, but when it came to performing live on stage, there was really no focal point. I mean, what lead singer sits behind the drums? They didn't use the stage very well, and audiences weren't exactly sure where to look. Karen has been described as awkward and goofy during this point in her career. They said things like, she wasn't very ladylike, wasn't very feminine, the word tomboy was thrown around a lot. Really, she was just a big kid at heart, and you would never know it by listening to her mature vocals that she was barely old enough to legally drink. But everyone wanted her to come out from behind the drums. Part of why she loved them, though, was they were her safety net, her shield. She never set out to be a star. That was Richard's department. She just wanted to sing and play drums and couldn't understand why she couldn't do both. Coming out from behind her drums was her worst nightmare. And it was about to happen. It really crushed her soul, but she stepped out from behind the drums. But I think that once she realized it wasn't going to deter from the success of Carpenters, she really embraced it and truly perfected her onstage makeover. And guess what Carpenters did a year later, on June 22nd, 1972? They released yet another album, their fourth. This one was called A Song for You, and once again, it contained a handful of hits. The first single became their sixth gold hit, and I can easily say it's in my top five favorite Carpenter songs.
No one in the world ever had a love as sweet as my love. For nowhere in the world could there be a boy as true as you love. All my love I give gladly to you.
Richard and Karen Carpenter, you have been able to jump that generation. Old folks like myself really enjoy your music, and the people, the young folks that are staying behind us really enjoy it too. To what do you attribute that success? Karen, you want to start?
Well, that's, I think it's got to do with a lot of things. I think it's partly timing. I think it's choice of material, and it's got an awful lot to do with his arranging, and I think some of it's luck. and a bunch of different things.
Well, I just think it's because it's an easy listening sound, you know. I mean, we're not the only people who, like, you know, like Nilsson with Without You, that tune can appeal to both. And Fifth Dimension,
like Bread. And a lot of people, Neil Diamond.
We're sort of an easy listening act, you know, and that's what appeals.
Do you consider yourself sort of pioneering?
Well, the soft sound was attributed to right when, like, Close to You came out and Make It With You by Bread came out, and then right after them came, let's say, James Taylor, and after that the Carole Kings, and the sound started to get softer, and it seemed to start, you know, kind of with Close to You and Make It With You, and then it just kept going.
The hits just continued to get churned out. Goodbye to Love, written by John Bettis and Richard, is actually considered the very first power ballad, because it's the first ballad to feature a guitar fuzz solo. And the story of how it was written is actually kind of great. Richard and Karen were huge fans of Bing Crosby, and late one night, Richard was watching a 1940 Bing Crosby movie called Rhythm on the River, about a guy who takes credit for songs written by ghostwriters. And in the movie, they refer to a song called Goodbye to Love. You only ever hear the title, you never hear the song. Richard loved the title, and with John's help, wrote the song he thought Goodbye to Love would have been. And once again, they turned out another gem.
Do you like music?
I adore it. Nothing will ever quite come up to Goodbye to Love.
I wrote that myself. I mean, that really came from my heart.
I'll say goodbye to love. No one ever cared if I should live or die. Time and time again, the chance for love has passed me by. And all I know of love is how to live without it. I just can't seem to find it.
The album also features a cover of Carole King's It's Going to Take Some Time, which Carole herself loved, even saying that Carpenter's version made hers seem like a demo. There's also another Paul Williams song, I Won't Last a Day Without You, which actually spent 14 weeks on the charts and became Carpenter's ninth number one single on the Easy Listening charts. But the final hit didn't come out until a year after the album was released, and almost didn't even come out as a single, but audiences and fans just kept requesting it over and over and over again. So Carpenters thought, we better put this out as a single, and good thing they did, because it's another one of those hits that some of their fans think of as their signature song. It was written by John Bettis while the group was on tour, flying from city to city. He was sitting in an airplane, looking out the window at the world below, and wrote a song that would spend 2 weeks at number one on the Billboard Top 100 chart.
Everything I want the world to be is now coming true, especially for me. And the reason is clear, it's because you are here. You're the nearest thing to heaven that I've seen.
We were asked in 1972 to stop by and meet the President of the United States. So we're then ushered into the Oval Office, and he's ever so pleasant to us. And of course, he asked what's our latest record and all of that. And it's pretty well known that he was not great at small talk. And Lord knows, Karen and I were rather nervous being around him. So he talked about amplifiers, how loud's your show, so on and so forth. And then we took a very nice picture. And that was that. year later, approximately, we were asked to play at a state affair at the White House. President Nixon has requested that the Carpenters really, they'd be the entertainment, which is an honor.
We think that tonight, having the Carpenters, one of America's finest young group in America, entertain us is most appropriate. The Carpenters, ladies and gentlemen.
On May 1st of 1973, the same day they performed at the White House, Carpenters released their fifth album. Agnes actually suggested the album's title, Now and Then, which is by far their most popular album cover because it features their actual house, this one right here on Newville. I mean, I think there's something so cool about it. It's just so rock star to me. Just come outside and have your album photo taken. But in actuality, Richard felt like a bit of an afterthought at A&M because there was never really any effort put into any of their covers. They just sent a staff photographer here and basically told them to come outside and pose. But Richard was now a car collector, so he managed to arrange a shot in a sports car, which turned out to be the three-panel pullout for the album. But if you look closely, you can tell on Richard's face that he's not exactly thrilled. On the album, you'll notice the left side of the house is now gone. It was actually an addition that the Carpenters used as their in-home studio. They rehearsed here, wrote here, listened to music all night here, and even displayed their certified albums and all of their memorabilia. But the new owners demolished it in 2008, and now it appears to be a Cheesecake Factory. Just giant house. Fans actually protested. They thought that the entire house was going to be demolished, but they really only tore down the studio. But back to the album, oldies were actually becoming a big fad at this point in the 70s, and many of the tracks were covers, like the Beach Boys' Fun, 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 End of the World, which we heard earlier, Do Run Run, Johnny Angel, Dead Man's Curve, and One Fine Day, to name a few.
Their parents brought them to California years ago simply to have them near the center of show business. Karen and Richard worked at their music and thought they were good. But for year after year, no one listened. They endured rudeness and rejection that would have broken the spirits of most hopefuls. And then it happened. Success so sudden, so overwhelming, that they're still a little dazed. They've sold 16 million records in the past 2 years. Karen, at 21, and Richard, 25, are millionaires. They own apartment houses and shopping centers. They still live at home with their parents in the not especially fashionable community of Downey. But that home is undergoing some explosive changes in keeping with the new status of its residents.
Why don't you have a seat?
Crazy chairs.
Oh, in case you're wondering where we got them, we didn't go out and have them made or anything. They're gifts from the Carol Burnett Show.
Every time you're on the Carol Burnett Show?
Every time you're on the Carol Burnett Show, you get chairs made while you're rehearsing and everything, and then they give them to you.
Enough appearances and you invite
your choir.
Yeah,
you can furnish your whole house.
Disappear each time I see your eyes, and no matter how hard I try to understand the reason why we carry on this way, we're lost in a masquerade.
Now, the album wasn't just all oldies covers. This Masquerade, I think, is one of their most beautiful songs. Sing was another huge single for the band, but believe it or not, there's a song on the album that is considered to be Carpenter's most successful selling single worldwide. And later on in the tour, we're going to see something else that pertains to it that I think is pretty special. But for now, I'll just tell you that it was written by Richard and John Bettis, and Richard has said that it's his absolute favorite of all the songs he ever wrote. And coincidentally, it's my all-time favorite Carpenter song as well. Now, I know I told you that I thought Superstar was their best, but this one is my favorite. And it was written in response to the oldies boom that was happening.
When I was young, I'd listen to the radio, waiting for my favorite songs. When they played, I'd sing along. It made me smile. Those were such happy times, and not so long ago. How I wondered where they'd gone. But they're back again, just like a long lost friend. All the songs I love so well. Every sha-la-la-la, every whoa still shines. Every yesterday once more.
All right, so not only did Agnes suggest the album title, but she was really around for a lot of the decision-making moments. Sort of, I don't know, seeing herself as part of the band or like it was a family business, and it wasn't good for her already strained relationship with Karen. Agnes just revered Richard. She treated him like a god, and a lot of family friends have said that Karen was almost treated like an afterthought. It was Richard all day, every day, whatever he wanted, whenever he wanted it. And Karen was still just a tag along in Agnes's eyes. Evelyn Wallace, the lady I told you who worked with Agnes at the NASA aviation place, the one who became the fan club secretary, well, she really spilled the tea in Randy's book, saying that Agnes flat out just preferred Richard over Karen. I mean, Karen was really the superstar of Carpenters everywhere in the world except for her own home. Harold was much sweeter and pretty mild-mannered, almost bullied by his wife, Agnes. He and Karen had a much, much sweeter relationship. And when Karen was 24, when Richard was approaching 28, they decided it was time to move out once and for all, but they had to come up with a plan, which was to buy this four-bedroom, 3,000-square-foot home basically in the same neighborhood, just less than 2 miles away from the Newville house. And they presented it as a gift to their parents, but Agnes wouldn't budge. She just refused to leave the Newville house. So the kids said, fine, stay there. We'll move here. But Agnes knew that with the music studio attached to the Newville house, that they'd be over all the time. And they were. But this house, built in 1973, would be Karen and Richard's new home. And Rolling Stone even sent Annie Leibovitz out here to photograph the duo for their July 4th, 1974 cover issue.
I've acted out my love in stages with 10,000 people watching. singing this song for you.
The Rolling Stone article is pretty interesting. Richard and Karen talk about moving into this house together and their squeaky clean image that journalists were always bringing up. They were accused of being wholesome and goody-goodies, but in this interview, they were pretty much able to dispel that. They said that they did indeed drink and that they even voted to legalize marijuana and that, yes, they even swore. I mean, they weren't big partiers, but they were also far from innocent and even addressed rumors of an incestuous relationship because a phone reporter from Toronto once dropped a bombshell on Richard by saying to him, "Look, I've listened to your lyrics. I know you wrote these songs for Karen and that she's singing them about you." Well, Richard was outraged, rightfully, and he hung up on the idiot. And he told Rolling Stone that he was appalled at the accusation and reminded them that he didn't even write every Carpenter song and that the idea was just absurd. And he was right. It was absurd. Because whenever you have a group of males, like the Beatles or Chicago or even Simon and Garfunkel, performing love songs, people aren't like, "Oh my God, are these songs about each other?" But you throw a female into the mix, and suddenly everyone becomes nosy and weird and wants to make it a thing. It was the 70s, the absolute peak of rock and roll. And here you have this incredibly successful band, compromised of a brother and sister, and nobody knew what to do with that. They even told Rolling Stone that photographers didn't know how to shoot them. They were always asked to pose like a couple. I mean, they really hated all their album covers. It was really frustrating. They basically just said, "Look, we either spend all our time touring together, recording together, or doing press together. So it makes perfect sense that we would share a house together."
Horizon, Carpenter's sixth album, was released on June 6, 1975, and was more successful in the United Kingdom and Japan than it was here. It peaked at number 13, but was the first Carpenters album not to crack the top 10. Still had three solid hits on it, though. Only Yesterday, Solitaire, and yet another number one single on Billboard's Hot 100 chart. Can't say that this one's one of my favorite Carpenter songs. It's a nostalgic cover, and I think they had a lot more sophisticated things coming out around this era, but not only was it number one here, it was number one in Canada, New Zealand, Australia, and South Africa.
Stop, whoa, yes, wait a minute, Mr. Postman.
Wait,
wait, wait, wait, Mr. Postman.
Please, Mr. Postman, look and see.
It wasn't released as a single because 2 years prior, it was a global phenomenon. And I know it's blasphemous to say this, but I prefer this version to the original. No offense to Don Henley or the Eagles or to Linda Ronstadt, who had her own marvelous cover with it. But there's something about Karen's vocals on this that is just so...
Desperado. Why don't you come to your senses? You've been out riding fences for so long now. Oh, you're a hard one, but I know that you've got your reasons. These things that are pleasing you can hurt you somehow. Don't you draw the queen of diamonds, boy. She'll beat you if she's able. You know the queen of hearts is always your best bet. You can't get
Carpenters absolutely dominated the music industry for really the entire first half of the 70s. Hit albums, hit singles, sold out tours, didn't really leave them any time for dating. Although around this time that they moved into the house, Richard was casually seeing Karen's hairstylist. All in all though, things started to slowly change for the duo. For starters, Karen's casual dieting became more intense, more compulsive, and definitely more noticeable. Fans actually gasped when they saw her on stage, and people even wrote to the fan club asking if she had cancer, and the fan club had to put out a statement assuring everyone that she didn't, saying that her weight loss was just from constantly working and traveling and touring. And she too started dating around this time. One of her more serious boyfriends was Terry Ellis. He was the co-founder of Chrysalis Records. He'd go on to pretty much help launch the careers of, oh boy, Billy Idol, Pat Benatar, Huey Lewis. He had just moved to LA after his record company took off, and Karen moved into his Beverly Hills house with him, but didn't last long. It was too fancy, too upscale, too adult, if you will. Can't believe I'm gonna say this, but Terry didn't have any televisions in his house, and Karen couldn't handle that. Don't blame her. She liked to watch television when she ate dinner, like a normal person, and he was an Englishman, too refined for that. So she moved out, ended up moving back home on Newville, but that didn't last long either, because being under the same roof as Agnes wasn't working out. So once and for all, Karen put her foot down, told her family she was getting a place of her own, and she did. 20th Century Fox, or Fox Studios, make up the central core of a neighborhood called Century City on LA's west side, about 28 miles from Downey, and it was here where Karen decided to get her very own place. It's mostly a commercial neighborhood, and in fact, her building provided Century City's first residential living when it was built in 1964 by famed architect I.M. Pei, who of course designed the Pyramid at the Louvre. They're called the Century Towers, and coincidentally, they are just a couple buildings away from the Century Plaza Hotel that we saw earlier, here on the glamorously named street Avenue of the Stars, which I guess makes sense because Diana Ross, Berry Gordy, Lana Turner, Burt Lancaster, Michael Douglas, and Catherine Zeta-Jones have all lived in the towers, which actually sit on 6 acres. Making it LA's largest luxury condo property. Karen purchased 2 units on the 22nd floor of the East Tower. She knocked down the walls and made 1 large corner unit. But the best part about her place, I kid you not, is that she had the doorbell wired to play the very first 6 notes of We've Only Just Begun. I love that so much. Karen had a small tight-knit group of close friends, one of whom was Olivia Newton-John, or Ange, as Karen called her. They met in 1971 and instantly became best friends. Ange was a frequent visitor here at the condo and has spoken openly about Karen's style, which apparently was chic and modern, yet designed with a massive Disney collection, particularly Mickey Mouse, who Karen always loved and even carried her obsession well into adulthood. Karen, like Olivia, was a massive superstar at this stage in her life. The two of them just, I mean, they had so much to bond over. Their similar lifestyles, touring, traveling, all the things that come with fame. And Ange recalled that Karen was just a big kid. She nicknamed everything and everyone. She called her parents the Rents and used abbreviation before text messaging was even around. She just was really cool and fun and funny. Richard was living at the Lubick House, and Karen was here when they released their 7th album on June 11th, 1976. It was called A Kind of Hush, named after the title track, a Herman's Hermits cover, and it was the first time that none of the singles hit it big. It's also the first album Karen didn't drum on. It's still certified gold, but by previous standards, just wasn't as successful. But there are 3 gems on it that I love. I Need to Be in Love, That was John Bettis's favorite song that he ever wrote for Karen, and not surprisingly, it was her all-time favorite of all the songs that she ever sang. Another great Bettis Richard song is I Have You, which I find completely underrated, but probably my favorite one wasn't even a single, but became a ginormous hit for Barry Manilow when he covered it 2 years later.
You came along just like a song. You brightened my day. Who'd believe you were part of a dream that only seemed like years away? And you know I can't smile without you. I can't smile without you. And you must
Karen's condo sits on the border of Century City and Beverly Hills, and she really tried to make Beverly Hills kind of like her own little Downey. She had her favorite grocery store around the corner, lunch spots, loved to shop, and one of her closest friends, a woman fittingly named Frenda, who still lives in Beverly Hills, by the way, recalls in Randy's book that one of Karen's favorite spots was this landmark chocolate shop right here in the heart of town on Cannon Drive. Edelweiss Chocolates opened in 1942, and the who's who list of customers is really too long to mention, but I will tell you that Katharine Hepburn loved it so much that she wrote about it in her autobiography. But the main reason I'm showing it to you is because anyone who knows Karen will tell you that she absolutely loved I Love Lucy. I'm sure you know where I'm going with this, but Lucille Ball was such a fan of this store that the classic Chocolate Factory episode of I Love Lucy was inspired by her own frequent visits here, and Karen found this just as exciting as any fan who comes here to visit it. She just loved Lucy, and Disney, and Mickey Mouse, and all the Americana stuff that really didn't make her that much different than your average American. I mean, except that she was a global superstar. This is the back entrance, the way that Lucy would discreetly enter the store as to not get mobbed, and she would see how everything was made, hence the inspiration for the show. All right, I know, I sound like I'm getting off track, but Karen loved I Love Lucy so much that she brought video cassettes of it along with her on tour, and would watch episodes in her hotel room and dressing rooms. And this was way before VCRs were even really around. And everyone knew that she loved TV and I Love Lucy. She loved Dallas, by the way. And a reporter was asking her, yeah, but what do you do to prepare for each show? And Karen was like, I get dressed and then go on stage. I just love that. So casual. So casual about being amazing.
In just 6 short years, from 1970 to 1976, Carpenters managed to have 16 consecutive top 20 hits on the main charts. And get this, every single they released hit either number 1 or number 2 on the adult charts. And they had 5 top 10 albums. There's also another crazy statistic, like they had the 10 fastest consecutive singles, something that neither the Beatles nor Elvis ever achieved. Really impressive numbers when it comes to Carpenter's music, but the late 70s were a lot different than the beginning of the decade, which they helped kick off. And as is the case with most artists, their success started to decline. They really tried to think outside the box and experiment with their sound on their 8th album called Passage, released in 1977. Now, this was the second album Karen did not drum on, and believe it or not, it's the first album that does not feature a song written by Richard or John Bettis. Part of this, aside from, you know, trying to come up with new ideas, was Richard was privately battling an addiction to Quaaludes. Now, he had been prescribed them in the beginning of the decade, and was using them properly up until around this time when he was just flat out abusing them. Now, he wasn't a partier, not in the typical rock and roll sense. He just developed an extremely common prescription drug abuse problem. But nonetheless, they still managed to put out a very critically and artistically successful album, but not a commercially viable one. Now, the album has a lot of variety on it, quite a collection of eclectic tracks. Three songs on there I love, though. I'll tell you about them quickly. The first one, Richard thought that Karen's voice would be perfect for Andrew Lloyd Webber's Don't Cry For Me Argentina from Evita. And he was right. She absolutely kills it. It's a little too long production-wise, but a fabulous track nonetheless.
Don't cry for me, Argentina. The truth is I never left you. All through my wild days, my mad existence, I kept my promise. Don't keep your distance.
There's also I Just Fall in Love Again, which A&M felt was a little too long at 4 minutes to be released as a single, something they should have really reconsidered, because the following year, Anne Murray released it and had a huge hit with it.
No, I just fall in love again. Just one touch and then it happens.
But probably the oddest, strangest, weirdest song ever is on this album. And I know I sound like a broken record when I say this, but it's another one of my favorite Carpenters tracks. It's called Calling Occupants of Interplanetary Crafts, a power ballad about making contact with spaceships and aliens. I'm not even a sci-fi or alien guy. I just love it, probably because of Karen's voice and the fact that it took over 160 musicians to bring this track to life. It's really one of the weirdest things they've ever done. There was even a television special around it starring Suzanne Summers. And oddly enough, it was one of their worldwide biggest hits. Really climbed the charts in other countries. Didn't do so hot over here. The movie Close Encounters of the Third Kind was a few months away from being released, and I think had that film come out, the song may have done better, because America's obsession with spaceships and aliens was really about to expand.
Not many groups can say they cut their first record in a garage.
Yeah. From a garage to outer space.
To outer space. To outer space. To outer space.
Calling occupants of interplanetary craft. Calling occupants of interplanetary most extraordinary craft. Calling occupants of interplanetary craft. Calling occupants of interplanetary ultra. We've been observing your Earth, and one night we'll make a contact with you. Calling occupants of interplanetary, quite extraordinary craft.
Give us a sign
that
and transmit thought energy far beyond the norm. You close your eyes, you concentrate, together that's the way to send the message we declare World Contact Day.
Good night, everybody.
And thank you for sharing our space encounter. Good night.
The Carpenter's Space Encounters. Brought to you by new improved Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo. Now with a special new conditioner. You're gonna swear you've got more hair.
1978 saw the release of Carpenter's wildly successful Christmas Portrait, an album I hold really dear to my heart. And I know I sound so cheesy and corny saying this to you, but I cannot recall a single Christmas where my family didn't listen to this album while we decorated our tree. But all in all, 78 was a pretty terrible year for Karen and Richard. By now, his addiction was so bad he could no longer perform. His hands were so shaky, but he admitted he needed help, which is something Karen couldn't do with her own problem. By now, she was in the midst of a full-on eating disorder and had truly become a master at disguising it. She would push the food around her plate and would offer everyone around her bites, saying, "Oh my God, this is fantastic, you have to try it," giving each person food until there was nothing left on her plate, creating this illusion that she had finished everything herself. She really lost a lot of weight. Her family and friends were so worried, but nobody knew yet just what they were dealing with. And she would just tell everyone that she suffered from colitis, an infection of the colon. The year went on, and in January of 1979, Karen took Richard to a rehab facility in Kansas. Now, prior to him going in, she had been toying with the idea of venturing off on her own to make a solo album, something Richard did not want to hear and something Agnes definitely didn't want to hear. She really flew off the handle, thinking that if Karen made a solo album, that would put a permanent end to Carpenters as a duo. But Karen put the plans in motion, and right before she dropped Richard off, she even managed to get his blessing, something she absolutely needed in order to make this album. But the one thing he said to her before she drove off was, "Karen, whatever you do, do not make a disco album." And on May 1st of 1979, Karen, who had traveled all over the world with Carpenters, mind you, took her very first solo plane ride to New York City to embark on her very own solo album. She started off living at the Plaza Hotel, but then a few weeks later moved in with the producer of her record, Phil Ramone, and Phil's wife, Karen Ichi Uji. Phil had produced Paul Simon, Still Crazy After All These Years, and Billy Joel's The Stranger. This was before he would go on to produce for, oh my God, Madonna, Celine Dion, Barbara Streisand, Natalie Cole, Sinead O'Connor. He did Frank Sinatra's iconic duets album. Really, Phil's resume as a producer is just sick. His actress-singer wife, Karen, is best known for her performance of Manhunt from the Flashdance soundtrack. And Karen, nicknamed Karen Ichiuji, Ichi, and the two of them became fast, close friends. But as far as Karen's album goes, she was really impressed with what Donna Summer was doing, with what Barbara Streisand was doing, with what her pal Olivia Newton-John was doing, and despite Richard's plea, set out to make a disco album. Now, Randy's book really dives into the making of the solo album, and the whole thing takes place in New York City, so I'm really just gonna breeze through it, but one fun tidbit that I love is that Phil brought in Rod Temperton from the band Heatwave. And Rod had two songs in their early stages, one called Off the Wall and the other one called Rock With You. He played them both for Karen, and she thought they were just a little too funky, a little too out there, so she passed on them. But a couple weeks later, Rod saw Quincy Jones at a barbecue and ended up playing the songs for Quincy, who of course pitched them to Michael Jackson, who of course knocked them out of the park. Phil even took Karen to Michael Jackson's recording session of Off the Wall, mostly because he wanted Karen to see the direction which Michael was going with his career, and because Michael Jackson was a huge Karen Carpenter fan. He could not believe that she was sitting in on his session. She really had a lot of fun and ended up picking two of Rod's other songs for her own album, Love Lines and If We Try. But, I mean, there's a part of me that really wishes Karen had done Rock With You. Would have been fun to see what she had done with that. But this was the first time that she was recording without Richard. It was also the first time that she wasn't recording in A&M Studios. But everything was going wonderfully. Billy Joel stopped by the recording session. He was very upset he wasn't playing on her album, but his band was. Paul Simon stopped by. He convinced her to cover Still Crazy After All These Years, which she did. And Peter Cetera from Chicago even wrote a song for Karen that they both performed for her album. Really, everyone in the music industry everyone in New York treated her like a queen. Once, Karen and Itchy went to a baseball game at Shea Stadium, and Karen noticed on the scoreboard the initials KC. She turned to Itchy and was like, "Itchy, those are my initials." Itchy was like, "Karen, relax. Stands for Kansas City." But just then, the announcer came on and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, we are so honored to have a special guest today. Please welcome Karen Carpenter." She ended up standing up, taking a bow, and the entire place went nuts, cheered for her. All in all, she and Itchy had a great time together, but Itchy knew that Karen had a problem. She found boxes of laxatives all over their house, and one night, while Karen and Itchy were watching Olivia Newton-John's new special, which Karen had been part of, Karen screamed in horror when she saw herself next to Tina Turner, Tony Tennille, and Olivia Newton-John, exclaiming that she looked absolutely fat. You know, the clues were all there, but nobody knew just what disease Karen had yet. She even collapsed one night at Phil and Itchy's and promised them that she would eat more and blamed the stress on making the album, which took an entire year to complete. It wrapped in January of 1980 in hopes of a spring release. And when it was finished, the New York team was absolutely ecstatic over the finished product. They thought for sure they had a smash on their hands. Phil could not wait to present a new Karen Carpenter for the 80s, a more mature, sophisticated Karen, whose lyrics were a little bit more provocative. They absolutely cheered this album. They had a party for it, champagne was flowing. But then Karen returned to LA, where she played the album for Richard and everyone at A&M, who sat in complete silence as track after track after track played. They sat stone-faced, staring at Karen, even asking her, "Why did you make this? What is this? What's it for? Why disco?" Agnes supposedly heard the album and reportedly said to Karen, "You will never be as good as Richard." She was devastated, absolutely crushed. Phil was devastated and absolutely crushed. A year's worth of work completely down the drain because they ultimately decided to shelve the project. The release was off.
Sometimes all the world.